Hey, we are live. Hey, everybody. Welcome to, live webinar. We're not really in a series or anything. This is a special webinar that we're putting on outside of all of our normal webinars and trainings. And the reason is because, as many of you may be seeing from my Facebook posts, or you've maybe you've reading my blog and whatnot, we are in a kind of a weird economy right now. Well, it's an election year. So it's always weird when it's an election year. And on top of that, I just had my guest speaker here, Mr. Greg Crabtree, speak at one of our Producers Club events. And he was sharing, we have a small group called the BFC Club. These are small, mid-size MSPs that are growing with the intent of either, you know, merging and continuing to grow or selling at some point. And the information he was sharing was really, really valuable. So let me first introduce Greg so you guys know who this is, because I know some of you are familiar with him because you've been in our world or our universe for a while, because he is one of our experts in residence. But there might be some of you out there that are brand new to TMT. Maybe you're not familiar with Greg. But Greg is a speaker. He's an author. He's an entrepreneur. He's also a financial expert. I would say profitability consultant is probably a better term. You may have read his book. It's Simple Numbers. I actually got, look at this. I have the copy right here. See that? I have it right there. I need to get you to sign it, Greg.
That's right.
And it's a fantastic book. It's a great read. It helps entrepreneurs, small business owners, to understand what many of you call would seem like the dark arts. I know, Greg, you sometimes talk about marketing being the dark arts, but I think for a lot of people watching this, the knowing the numbers in your business, what levers to pull, what is good, what is bad, how do you know if you're profitable? If you're not profitable, where do you look? I think a lot of people don't know that. And his book really breaks that down very just simply, just like it says, simple numbers, so that you understand here's how to look at the numbers in your business. He is, like I said, an expert in residence on MSP financials and profitability for our members. And by the way, if you are a member, Greg did a fantastic one-day workshop a couple of years ago and just broke down the most basic of basic things for MSPs in their business. That's available to all of our members. So make sure you get, read that if you want to continue your education. But Greg is also, he founded CRB, or Crabtree, Rowe and Berger PC, which is a top 25 CPA firm. I think top 25 in the country. Is that right?
We merged into Carr, Riggs and Ingram, which is a top 25 CPA firm. So
there you go. Yeah. Okay. I knew that. I just want to make sure that. Yeah. And so they manage, Greg, did I hear you right? Say it's over $1 billion in revenue that you manage for different small businesses. At this point,
it's larger than that in terms of what we manage, but of the companies in our study model, it's a $1 billion 100 company model of companies that we study for what we think is actually happening in the economy. Unlike the federal government, who likes to make up numbers, you know, to fill in the gaps of what they don't know, we just take the data of what we do know, and it's become a pretty telling story of tracking that.
Yeah. I mean, so again, like Greg's saying, we're in an election year, so you're not going to get the truth in numbers, period, full stop. A lot of the reporters don't even know what the hell they're talking about half the time when they're giving any kind of numbers. And the government really doesn't know until tax returns come in like a year and a half later or whenever they come in. What we're going to hear today, I asked Greg to share, is sort of some of what he's seeing in the economy, what we can expect. Let me just give you a couple things, Greg, and then I'll turn it over to you to share. But we polled our members. This is not data that we actually collect, which is on close rate of, you know, how long it takes to close a deal, how easy it is to close a deal, that sort of thing. But 63% of MSPs that we polled said they're seeing the close rate of proposals go down and they're seeing it take a lot longer to close deals. We have heard from a lot of our members, they're getting more price sensitivity now than ever. That kind of correlates maybe with where we are in the economy, but The other thing, Datto just released an industry report and said the ratio of new MSPs starting up to those that are being merged or acquired is 3-1. So for every MSP that's getting merged, acquired, or going, you know, kind of not off the market, but merging with another one, three more are popping up. And of course, these are smaller guys. And the way small guys compete is they, you know, do things cheap, right? So you're seeing that. This is data we do have. The reported number of inbound leads for MSPs has dropped 40% since January. So we're seeing that drop. The cost of leads has gone up exponentially. To get a qualified lead has gone up. It's an election year, so obviously politicians are spending billions of dollars, probably another record year in political ad spend, which on digital media drives up the cost of everything. It's like Christmas, you know, digital marketing just, you know, goes through the roof when at Christmas time, because all these advertisers are spending money, political ads, that's what's happening right now. And a couple other data points, according to service leadership data, the average MSP is only generating about 9% in net profit. And 16% of MSPs are not profitable at all right now, which is actually improved a little bit. That's good. But year over year, growth is starting to slow. So we've seen only, I think, 1.8% growth in Q2 over Q1. So everything is kind of, the leads are slowing down, close rates slowing down, more price sensitivity. You know, we just saw, you know, the other day, the markets took a tumble. I know they're rebounding, so we're seeing that. So it kind of paints a bleak picture, especially the jobs report coming out. So, Greg, I mean, what are your thoughts on all this?
Well, I think the general market in total is finally catching up to the economic reality that we've been seeing in the data for the last, you know, 6 to 9 months. And that, unfortunately, is the fact that, you know, just think about it. Everybody's on this call. Everybody on this call is probably a privately held business. I doubt there's any public companies that are represented of the audience. And so I just ask you one simple question. What does the government know about your data from last year, right now? And the answer is zero. And trust me, they don't look at tax returns for economic data. Taxes on a different basis of accounting mostly. So you really never use tax returns for economic indicators. They don't have eyes on the private part of the economy. The last number that I heard that was a reliable source said that 60% of US GDP or more is privately held businesses. I got news for you, it's probably more, because if you look at a public company's financial statements and look in the cost of goods sold section, that is us. We are the cost of goods sold section for those public companies, because they don't do stuff anymore. They contracted out to us. And so we have, in the last 25 years, have shifted from a public company dominant economy to a private company dominant economy. Good, bad, or indifferent, I think that's good. I think we are actually far better run, far more stable, and far more strategically run better as a private company, because we play the long game. We don't have to play short-term games. There's always going to be a public market for one reason or another. We'll get off in that ditch some other day. But at the end of the day, we are the heart of the economy. And as what we've seen is, and when I did my second book, Simple Numbers 2.0, and released it in 2020, I started a study model that was based on 2013 data. And I'll show you some slides here in a second of that trend. And we just started. I didn't go to the data to try to prove a point. I said, I don't know what it says. Let's just start tracking companies' activity that we have access to and put it in a common language, common format, and filter out the distortions that happen in private companies, owner compensation not being properly recorded, and those types of things, you know, and so put it in our structure of revenue, less COGS, it's not labor, isolate labor so we can see those trends. Well, you know, what we started to see was just a massive disconnect with what was being reported. And I'm thinking, okay, well, that's just temporary. And then over the years, we realized that we were onto something, because our data is completely different. And then as we've gotten into groups like technology marketing toolkits, you know, subgroups, you know, we've gotten insights into certain industries. So not only do we have groups in the MSP space, we've got HVACs, we've got building supply companies, we've got the home builders, both renovation and new construction that we do. we got landscaping groups that we do, and we've got marketing groups, you know, that we do. And so we get a really nice blend of that. And so it takes us even further. But we really settled in on this, what we call the simple numbers 100 company model. And I'll show you some data. So let me share my screen, and we'll kind of get into that and just let the data speak for itself, you know, in that. And okay, one second. Let's draw this. Share. Okay. And then we go to present mode.
Peter just mentioned that you're doing, I guess, what he means, quality of earnings, really, is what you're looking at. So
exactly. I mean, to a certain degree. I mean, you know, that's it. But these are both of the books. And so essentially, just to give you a framework of the way, you know, what we think. So Robin said, you know, we're profitability consultants. That's pretty accurate. But what we want you to do is use profits to build either wealth that gets harvested or wealth that grows the business further, depending on what the market allows you to do. And part of our thinking model here starts with this assessing market conditions. You know, the market for the last, you know, since World War II has generally been an upward move. Now it has pauses, it had some recessions, but there was generally growth largely because of population demographics. We've hit a skid here at the moment, though, that the marketplace is a dramatically different picture going forward. So you need to open your mind to new data points, form your own opinions, less listen to whoever you want. But I will tell you, you've got to really think differently about the market that's coming at us rather than the market that was. And you've just got to make a clean break of old thinking and just hit a reset. And you may continue an idea that does work, but you may, you know, get rid of ideas that don't. So looking at these assessments, trying to get a hold of good data. I will tell you that the group that for the BFC club that we manage, I'll just go ahead and spill the beans right now. That group is performing well above what our 100 company model is performing. They've been able to beat some of those trends, but it's not because it's not as much as industry as the actions that they're taking. And so we'll get into some of those when we look at the details. We want to clear distortions, make sure you're looking at truthful information, quit lying to yourself. You got to get profit what you got. I mean, why would you grow a business that's not currently profitable? And we believe the cornerstone to building a great business is if you're past $2 million of revenue, you better be profitable what you got, or else you got something broken. And so don't try to grow something that's broken until you fix it. And then you want to be fully capitalized, which means I've got cash of an appropriate amount. There's a defined number in our methodology. But then you look at now you can make choices to harvest that profitability and stay where you're at or try to grow and penetrate the market. Here's the first thing I will tell you. The market in total is not going to grow. So just get that out of your head. For you to grow going for the next 3 to 5 years, you must get market share growth, not your share of market growth. That is a massive, massive distinction, which means everybody has got to up their game. And as Robin has mentioned, my phrase of the last 25 years was the participation trophy economy. You could grow in spite of yourself because the economy was just massively, probably the greatest economic expansion was probably the last 20 years, you know, that we had. That's over. And great that it happened. Now, this is a street fight economy. You got to go punch your competitor in the face and take their customer away from them. And are you ready to do that? Because you've not had to do that to get the growth that you've had in the last 5 to 10 years. And so, you know, better buckle up. I mean, because this is a different place. So this is the data set I was talking about. When I started tracking this in 2014, government data is down here, you know, 3.5% GDP growth. Well, our model had 20%. And I'm thinking, okay, that was just an anomaly. Okay, it'll come back closer next year. Well, the next year I was at 14% and they were at 3.6. Okay. Well, the next year I was at 15 and they were at 3.25. It's like, dang, I mean, something's wrong here. 2017, change of presidency from 2016 to 2017, 23%. Second year, 23%. But 2019, we dropped to 8%. Now, this is before COVID. And we started seeing it in the running data. We look at rolling 12, rolling 3 data trends. we hit the wall in access to labor. We ran out of excess labor in the fall of 2019, and that started to mute real growth. Now, what did that cause? It got clouded by COVID when everything kind of dropped down, but then it spiked in the most aggressive inflation in my lifetime that I've seen in real terms, because we had a shortage of labor and everything just went crazy and everything had to reset. Now, as the prices went up, market settled in, we had a second increase in 22, and then we fell back into 23, this normative run rate of, okay, the spike is over. We still got inflation, but it's more like 6%. But I would contend in 21 and 22, we were seeing inflation rates. And I'll give you a good data point. This is a good reference data point. So we do this HVAC group that is about $100 million of revenue of the companies that are in it. In the last 3 years, their revenue has gone up 66%. Their headcount over that three-year period went up 10%. That tells you that it was 50% inflation and everything went up roughly. Their cost of goods went up, their labor went up, their operating costs went up. Everything went up at roughly that same rate. I mean, and it was just stunning. But here's the thing. HVAC, they're what we call a necessary. When you're hot, you want them. When you're cold, you want them. Same thing with MSPs. MSPs are necessaries. It's just the question of, are you going to hold your position in the market of being a good, necessary company in that process? Here's the thing that both HVAC companies and MSPs have in common, though. While you are a necessary, some of your customers are discretionaries. And you're going to see in a moment, I'm going to show you some of the difference between what we call the upstairs, downstairs U.S. economy. Here's the companies that are up. These are all the necessaries. Here's the companies that are down. They're the discretionaries. And if you are an MSP that is picked, and this goes back to the heart of Robin talking about high value customers. A high value customer is somebody who's not a discretionary business because they're going to struggle. And you're going to be fighting with them to get your core value, much less any premium value. When you do work for necessaries, they want it now, they want it fast, and price isn't an object. They just want it to work. That's a difference, massive, massive difference. And so you've got to look to your customer base. It's great that you are a necessary, but you are still impacted by the discretionary part of the market.
Yeah. And I would also say, you know, they're necessary, but that there is a lot of increased competition right now. Like I mentioned, there's 3-to-1 startups and MSPs, because I think people do see the opportunity. So, you know, while there's you are a necessity to your point, you know, you've got to go take a customer away from somebody in order to grow. And you know, some of the advice that we're giving our customers, and we'll get into this later, is just to, you know, make sure you're going into your existing customer base, mining what is there and what is,
right.
I mean, you know, I'll just give you a little data point too, Greg, you'll find this interesting. We run this program called Rapid Implementation, and we get members that come in, we put them through a 2-day workshop. It's like a little bit of prep, 2-day workshop, 17 weeks. And out of that, our average MSP adds almost $230,000 in new revenue in 3 months, 90 days. Yeah. And the majority of that's coming from going back to your existing customers. They just don't know how to mine that opportunity out of there. So,
yeah. And that's pretty consistent. What we've seen of all of our TMT client community that we work with, they have really, really, really done well of mining that activity. And so we see it firsthand, and it has made a massive impact in terms of the group's profitability to cause them to have a better performance standards, you know, than our overall general company model. The challenge is still, you know, kind of fighting to get that new customer. And I do think, you know, you mentioned about the 3 new startups for every 1 that sells. This is me, you know. Hey, I'm just a chicken farmer from Alabama that learned accounting, you know, so take it for what it's worth. I think it's harder than ever now, though, to go hang out your shingle. I really, really think, not they won't all fail, But I think you will see a higher failure rate of those people who go hang their shingle out, because we've actually seen in the MSP space, a couple of people almost get handed $1 million or under book of business that somebody hung their shingle and realized, oh crap, I'm in over my head. And so part of it is, I'll plant the seed now, get to know every one of these new guys that hangs out their shingle. Go have a cup of coffee with them every now and then, and just be ready to have them hand you that book of business when their key tech or something breaks, they have a cyber attack that they weren't ready for. That and that, I mean, you can sell so hard against, you know, that single new guy that hung out a shingle, because let's face it, I mean, we're all dead in the water if our technology goes down. I can't name hardly a single business that can't function without it. So anyway, so this gives you a sense of the ups versus downs. So one of the things we started doing is we noticed during COVID, okay, well, let's go one step deeper. Let's look at, of the companies that are up, what's the percentage of those, and what's the percentage of revenue that's down? So pre-COVID, we kind of think a normal economy is 80% of the revenue represented in that model are companies that are up year over year, 20% are down year over year. You can see during COVID, 55% were down, 45% was up, but largely generally stable though. 21, heat on the economy, but still only 83% were up and, you know, 17 were down. 22, we got back to the 80-20, but in 23, here's where, you know, we were two-thirds down and one-third up. And that really started, you know, this weakness issue of anybody who was a discretionary business, literally, you know, just got exposed that, you know, if you're the kind of business that I don't have to have it, I can postpone it, I can do less of it. Those people started getting it handed to them. And so here is the percentage of difference. And so when you look at these, you know, in terms of the rate of up versus the rate of down, the ups were up 21% in 19. In the ups in COVID, there were some businesses that really killed it during COVID. They were up 23%. In 21, this is where I'm telling you, inflation was absolutely rampant, and the government does not want to let on what the real number was. These companies were up 28%. They were up. And I'm telling you, 20% or more of that was price increases, not activity. It's just price increases. And then you got 20s here, and you're still, even in 23, it was still like, you know, 14% up of the ones that were up. Those are mostly people that are necessary businesses that can pass through their cost inputs. It's not adding body count. But the downs, these are horribly down, you know, 12, 12, 10, 8, and then, you know, 17, you know, was 23. Mm-hmm. So let's get in. I'll show you some actual data so you can kind of process this. So this is the overall company model. Notice a couple of things here. So the 12 months ended June of 23, labor was going up at 9%, revenue was going up at 6.7. So what that means is I'm stressing. I'm not able to raise revenue across the whole body of $1 billion of revenue. I can't raise prices fast enough to cover my labor cost increases. That number got close to the same number for this past 12 months. So you're starting to see moderation, that labor was only up 5% instead of 9. And what I'm telling you is this 9% labor increase, that's not bodies. These people didn't, in the net of all of this $1 billion, it's hard to measure exact FTEs, but I'm telling you, we talk to these people every day. They, as a market in total, they didn't add headcount. Labor force is flat, you know, for the most part. Now, the good news is gross margin percentage went up. What does that mean? That means people were able to improve their pricing. And so they keep pushing. Every call that we have of a client, have you pushed hard enough? Have you pushed hard enough? Where's the soft spots? Where's the things that aren't as price sensitive? Make sure you don't leave those things on the table. So like in our TMT community. You know, yes, the per seat count is the one thing everybody thinks about. But when you're doing projects, when you're doing upgrades, I'm not competitively bidding against that. I just need to charge a good number. I can't be egregious, but you know, am I leaving money on the table? So those have all worked well. And so our key measure of direct labor efficiency, LERs, labor efficiency ratio, gross margin to every dollar of direct labor, we see increasing margin relative to a dollar of labor. That is excellent. But there's one thing I worry about that, because management LER is declining down here. And that means for every dollar of contribution margin, how much do we get of that for every dollar of management labor? Here's my worry. We're holding on to ineffective, non-performing management labor and beating the crap out of our direct labor to make up for it without restructuring or being direct. And we say management labor for MSPs. Management labor includes your salespeople, any marketing people on staff, you know, and any executive, you know, senior leadership. And really, I will tell you, I personally think we're at an inflection point of the next major shift in management structure. The last major management shift was when Jack Welch eliminated all the middle management from GE and sent those guys packing. We probably haven't had a major management shift since, but the economics are forcing us to really look at player coach type managers. I need a manager that also does stuff and not just positional. And so, you know, and you see that in, you know, sales structures. And so depending on how big of a sales team, can I afford a sales VP that doesn't sell themselves? Probably not. I mean, I would think. But there again, I don't really care. You get to make that decision. Here's the deal. We know in the world of MSPs that there's kind of an optimal number. We looked at so many data sets in that community. We feel like the median numbers, we want a 3.5 direct LER, we want a 3.5 management LER. If I'm lower on one, I've got to be higher on the other. The two play off of each other. At the end of the day, it's this total LER here at the bottom that is the magic number. And for MSPs, no, there's two. So I can send you packing right now and say, listen, the only number you need to remember is two. You got to get $2 of gross margin. So after your direct cost of your third-party stuff and your hardware, I got to get $2 of gross margin every month for every dollar of payroll, regardless of what that payroll does.
All right, let me pause you.
Magic number.
Yeah, I want people to understand that, because just so in the MSP world, cost of goods sold is going to be all the tools you use to service somebody, hardware,
any subcontractors.
Cost of goods, right? Mm-hmm. Direct labor is the your employees, your engineers that are directly doing the work that you just sold. They're mm-hmm. doing the projects, they're doing the ticketing systems, they're doing the whatever, right?
Yep.
Management is functional leaders in your organization, sales, marketing, operations, CEO, you're the CEO. It gets a little, like, I guess it gets a little weird if someone watching this is small, because they might be the CEO and sales and marketing and technical labor, mm-hmm. but, yeah. You know, but so, but
and,
if,
and in those cases, I want, if you're the owner of the business, I want you in management labor, because you are eventually going to shed those jobs and hire somebody else to do it.
But what you're saying is take your total labor cost and divide that into your contribution margin, which is gross margin.
Yep.
Revenue minus cost of goods. Yep. And you should get $2 of gross margin for every dollar of salary you're paying. And
that's
if
right.
You're doing that, you're good. And
so we've inched our way into August. So I can say, okay, we'll back up a week. You knew on the first day of August what your payroll was within a gnat's eyelash. Take that payroll number, gross wages, don't add payroll taxes. That's all a waste of time. Just gross wages. Take that gross wages, multiply it times two. That's your gross margin target for this month. Same thing for September. You know today probably what you're going to spend unless you make staff changes for September. Take that number times two. That's your gross margin for September. So you then all you have to do is ask yourself two simple questions. Have I sold enough? And can I produce enough? If I sold it, then can my team produce it? And that's where really the top shelf managers, executors, just because you sold it, yes, that's great. But I got to get it past the cash register too, because you know, this is the beauty I love about MSP model. You know, 60% of your gross margin on day one of the month of your monthly recurring revenue is kind of generally where that's going to be. So then I got 4 weeks to fill the gap and push through, you know, all the other things. And when you put it, when you bring that target to the nearer term, it's going to elevate the intensity of your sales team. It's going to elevate the intensity of your field team to get it done, but also engaging your field team to help the sales team look for those add-on opportunities that the company's holding back on. And everybody's holding back. There's absolutely 100%. I mean, every call that we're having right now, people are sitting on their hands and they have cash. So it's not that they can't do it. They just have this fear. But I believe there actually is activity in this industry for you guys to get project sales. And I will tell you, I think one of the best stories to tell right now is this. My belief is we've got pent-up demand building in the market right now across the board, you know. And as soon as the election is done and there is a known president, doesn't matter which side in reality, you know, from a release point, the market is going to release because they will have a framework of knowing what kind of rules of the game is going to be depending on which party wins. So pick your party. That part, you know, I don't care about. You will see this release of activity. If you got somebody that has a critical upgrade that needs to be done, now is the time for them to do it because there will be this surge of activity post-election. And if they need it done quickly, everybody's going to be fighting over the same resources. Now, here's my caution. The surge will be temporary. It will last probably 6, maybe 9 months tops. So what I'm warning people of, that because the two atoms that are needed for a successful economy is supply and demand. We don't have enough of each quantity because we don't have enough people to create supply and we don't have enough people to create demand. You got to have an increasing population to increase demand or sell international trade. Hey, international trade is pretty much over, folks. I mean, we're pretty much, we gotta be selling to each other inside. You know, we can go Mexico and Canada maybe, you know, but we're quickly becoming a very contained economy, which is not all bad. But there again, be careful to permanently add infrastructure based on the surge that will come post-election. You've got to set your team as it is today and push them to the max of their executional ability before you add permanent. I mean, you can always turn off costs, but it's painful. But what you don't want to do is think that we're back on a run rate. There's just not physics enough in the marketplace to create the demand that we've seen in the last 20 years. Now, if you find a particular niche of the market that you can really go mine deep and hard, okay, that might be a different decision. We'd have to talk about that because I can't fathom any right offhand that is got deep water fishing.
Mm-hmm. What do you think is going to happen with inflation? Do you think it's going to continue to increase? Do you think labor rates are going to continue to increase, or are they going to?
It's going to continue. And here's my theory. All right, so think of it like this. So you've got $608 million of gross margin represented in this model. I got $200,000 of direct labor, and I've got $125,000 of management labor. So if you take $325,000 of total labor to that gross margin. So
million.
$325 million, right? And so that represents about 55% of the value stream, you know, that's in there. But there's 55% of that number that's somebody else's labor in COGS. There's 55% of these other numbers, this marketing number, there's labor that is in those services. There's that labor. So anywhere, my theory is 55 to 60% of every, you know, dollar that's generated has labor supporting it somewhere in the value chain. So if labor goes up 10% in raises, inflation has to be 6% just to maintain. So all you have to do is watch the true wage movement, and that's going to tell you. And so until you see 2 million people get kicked out of their current jobs to push in unemployment, true unemployment to 5 to 6%, you're going to keep having inflation. It has to happen. Our businesses will fail. Their numbers do not work unless they raise prices. And we still haven't gotten to the point of probably true unemployment yet. I mean, there are some people that are unemployed, but they're either not willing to move to where the jobs are, or they're not willing to do the jobs that are available. It's not that jobs aren't available. It's just the one they want's not available. I mean, I grew up in the 60s and 70s. We had real unemployment. When we had 11% unemployment in the 70s under Carter, I mean, my God. I mean, you had people that were living on handouts from the church and the community, and you had a lot more single wage earner families back then as well. You know, that was real unemployment. You know, and so, you know, so I look at the labor numbers, and I look at total workforce, and I look at you know what real unemployment is, and then I look at the average progression of wage increases. And if you've got good people right now, you're still probably raising those people minimum 5% to as much as 10% or more if they're moving upscale in skill set.
Yeah. And I think one of the things that is persistent also, and maybe not unique to this industry, but definitely in this industry, is that the engineers, the high level engineers, the techs, are, you know, they're not just walking around. Like I've heard you say that once you get below 3% unemployment, you're employing the unemployable, meaning
actually
like
five.
Okay.
Yeah, so yeah, like, once you're below 5% unemployment, you're scraping the bottom.
Right. You're hiring someone who can fog a mirror at that point. Right. You know, right. So I think, you know, one of the things that I'm pointing out, knowing that we're in a tight labor market and probably going to continue that way, knowing that inflation is going to be persistent and prices are going to have to go up. And knowing that all of the people on this call right now, especially when you're smaller and you can't offer the benefits that these bigger companies can offer. You have to really think about the quality of the customer you're getting, because there's only so much technical labor you have, or quality. It's not like they're walking around. You could just go, well, I'll just hire another one tomorrow if we grow and so forth. It's kind of like the example I give, Greg, is like there's a down at the in the Florida beach house that I have. There's a restaurant that I really like, and I've got to book this months out to get a table at it, you know, that's not 4 o'clock in the afternoon or 10 o'clock at night, right? And you know, I saw it during COVID. It's still continuing. You know, you walk in and, you know, I have this reservation for 2 months and I look around and not all the tables are full. And this is like the second, third time it's happened. And, you know, I said to the waiter, I said, you know, I had to wait to like book this 2 months out and not everything's full. Why is it so like, you can't book the tables and yet they're not full. And he looked at me, he says, we can't find people to serve the tables or the kitchen staff.
Yep.
So
yep.
If you're an MSP and you have, you're kind of like the restaurant still has the rent, the utilities, the insurance, they still have these tables there. But if they don't fill that restaurant with high value customers, you know, people, you know, if they're doing stupid things like Groupon ads or whatever it is that they're doing, they're going to flounder. And so that's why I think right now, like we're coming up on our roadshow that we're promoting and you know, our members are joining, and we're urging them right now to shift their focus from any leads or more customers, more leads, like anything that'll, you know, anything for a buck, to being very much strategic and discerning about who they're taking as a customer, targeting those high value customers, developing them more and growing that way. So you're getting more revenue and profits with fewer and less clients and employees. I mean, do you want to talk to that?
Absolutely. I mean, the restaurant is a great microcosm of kind of what's happening, because you've got upper tier, mid tier, low tier restaurants. The upper tier, We've actually had multiple famous U.S. restaurants go out of business in the last 3 years. There's the most famous restaurant in the world was in Greenwich Village, and it was ranked number one in the world. It went bankrupt. You had two top-end restaurants in L.A. went bankrupt because they didn't mind the common things that have to happen. I have to charge an amount relative to my cost input. And so if I'm late to the game and don't charge enough, I lose money. If I raise my prices, but I don't deliver the service that is expected for that price, I lose customers and I die. And you're seeing that all across the continuum of each of those restaurant types. I think the middle tier restaurants are actually in the most dangerous position, because for them to raise prices pushes them up into the lower end of the upper tier restaurants, but they don't have the service quotient in their staff's mindset to deliver that kind of experience, and the menu and stuff is just not, it's like, I paid how much for this? And so in the low ends, I mean, you've seen all the news reports of multiple fast food franchises going bankrupt, especially the ones that were bought by PEs. Those have been a disaster. You look at some of the markets, like California's new $20 an hour minimum wage for food service workers has just destroyed, the labor market out there. But, they've had to raise prices, and it comes back down to, as I said, it all starts with what price do I have to charge for the cost input that I have? Because you can turn that knob as far as you can, but if I stop serving my customer, they will find somebody else to serve them. And that's really kind of the key. Here's the one thing, the last thing to note before I go into the ups and downs. Notice that even though the ups, they're still down in net operating income as a percent to sales slightly, but they're stable. So they're hanging in there. Here's where it really gets messy, though, is when you look at this group, this kind of orange section. These are the companies that were up. So 70% of our overall model are companies that are up, 30% of the ones that are down. And you can see same profile. Direct LER is continuing to increase. Management LER, in their case, because they're the ups, they've actually seen an increase. So they've actually challenged management labor. Yes, I'm spending more money on management labor, but I've had to reset my contribution margin target for what they produce. So these are certainly more stable. And you can see they've also increased in profitability. They've gone from 7.16 to 8.85. More importantly, profit to gross margin being 17%. Anything 15% or higher is in the green for us in terms of profit to gross margin, which I think is a cleaner measure for all businesses. Mm-hmm. The downs, this is the story that you don't want to be. Yes, their direct LER is up. So business managers naturally will adjust that. But remember, that's who you make money off of. But notice what they're not adjusting. Management LER is 3.9, 3.8, and then dropped to 3.48. They're holding on to too much management labor, and they're not cutting and restructuring that piece of the business fast enough. And you can see that they've dropped 40% in profitability from 10% down to 6.6. I mean, these businesses are in trouble. Mm-hmm. But goes back to our simple number of two. The ups, 1.89 total LER. The downs, 1.83. That 6 cents makes a massive difference in profitability. And this group has been in the twos, in recent past. And so this is still the continuing fight. As labor costs continue to move on you, can I adjust prices and throughput of the business I've got to just get narrower in time zone of my focus. And that's why we really preach for MSPs monthly measurement of here's my total labor at the beginning of the month. Two times that number is my gross margin target for that month. And I got to find a way to hit it month after month after month. Mm-hmm. And you do that, you're going to be successful. And that's really kind of the key. Kind of some general comments, and then I'll get specific to the industry. I mean, so just remember, when people start talking about COVID had nothing to do with us. We'd be here whether COVID happened or not, in my opinion. This labor shortage is permanent because of demographics. We were at a 2.4 replacement birth rate in the U.S. in 2000. We're at a 1.6 based on 2023 data. We'll probably be a 1.5 once 24 data comes out. All you people that can still have kids, let's get busy. You know, I had four kids. I've only got six granddaughters, and I keep telling my kids I need three more. We got to get our quota. You know, so come on, who's going to step up? Inflation, it's going to be real. I mean, I hate that the Fed has hung their strategy on this one number, because we've never been in a time like this before with no excess labor. And so they're managing off of an old theory. And I get it. Nobody likes inflation. But let me ask you this. Would you rather have 5% inflation and no unemployment to speak of? Or would you rather have no inflation and have an extra 3 million people unemployed that we all have to be taking food to each week? I mean, you can't have both. Which one? I can do the math on 5% inflation. I think, you know, it's not Argentina inflation. You know, they had 20% per month inflation. It's manageable. Like I said, we're living in an upstairs downstairs economy, because you can't make a general statement about the economy and be correct, because it's two different worlds of the necessaries versus the discretionaries. But yeah, you can still win. And I mean, anybody who's hanging out in the TMT world, you want to be a winner, and you're going to do better, you know, than the ones who aren't, because we've got clients that are part of the TMT community, and we got clients who aren't in the same industry. And I'm telling you, the ones who aren't in the community, we keep prodding them to say, hey, you need to be hanging out with these other folks and getting some of that juice, because they just tend to underperform. They can hang in there, but they're just generally 5% or more less profitable than the group that's feeding off of each other. And you know, kind of repeat of the participation trophy versus street fight mindset. And, you know, this is really where we got to live. And so kind of here's our prescription, and we can kind of go in some of Robin's thoughts on this. You know, I cannot stress enough, just wipe your brain clean of everything you thought about economics prior to this year. Take a fresh look and analyze what do you see? What is it telling you? Don't go to it with a preconceived idea. Read it and react. Are your customers necessarily discretionary to the market? And a lot of you vary major. One of the folks I talked to, you know, recently, you know, he was out on the West Coast and had lost quite a few customers, you know, that went bankrupt, that were VC-backed companies. Those are hard to replace, because you're sitting there feeling pretty good about it. But they were in a discretionary part of the market because they were venture-backed, not profitable on an ongoing basis. So if you have any of those customers, understand the VC world isn't interested in putting up the second and third rounds like they used to be if somebody's not showing promise. Are your customers being prone to being sold? More importantly, listen for who's in the roll-up discussion. You're more likely to lose an MSP customer that gets rolled up versus one that just gets bought and is a standalone bought. You got a good chance of probably keeping that one sometimes. But then this hyper-focus on a range of high-value clients, and I say range intentionally, don't pick one industry. And I'll give you a good example of this from our HVAC group. During COVID, my HVAC group crushed it, except for one client in that group focused on restaurants in LA. That was his focus. They were all closed, you know, for the whole year of 2020 and into 21. Now he survived, but he's thriving now, but he's learned a lesson to kind of tweak. He's not taking on just any restaurant. He's profiling them and picking the ones that he thinks got legs to stay in the game. And so you've got to have that kind of read of the landscape. And this part, Robin said, I've often told the group, I said, you know, marketing, I think, is a black art. You got to do it. You got to spend money. And so we are adamantly telling clients, and our data shows they're not cutting back their marketing spend. they are changing what they're spending it on. Here's something that I told the group, you know, when I, the BFC club a couple of weeks ago, when I met with them, said, just think about this. I think in 24 months, Google is going to be, well, they're going to be in trouble long before then. But in 24 months, people aren't going to use Google to do a search. And so there will be no more pay-per-clicks or AdWords because you will search with AI, which AI is not influenced by pay-per-clicks and AdWords. Just let that sink in for a moment, because as we start to search differently, you've got to really think differently about where to deploy the dollars to get the return on investment. And now pay-per-click and SEO, you know, type activities are there for the moment, but just understand that landscape is going to change, and just don't fall asleep. But more importantly, I will tell you, with the growing, the explosive growth that we had in the last 20 years, it eliminated so much human sales talent from the system that people were patting themselves on the back, breaking their arm to do it, when they didn't have nothing to do with it. They were order takers. They weren't market makers. And we've now introduced, to get these high value customers, hyper focus on leads, now more than ever, we need that human to get that transaction across the finish line. But there's a limited amount of talent available. And I think for the most part, I don't know that the talent available is worth a crap. I really think you've got to take, you know, I mean, Robin, you know, wrote the book on how to do it. It doesn't take a genius. You just got to get the person with the right motivation, the right energy, you know, to just go execute that game plan. And you know, in this last statement, I cannot stress enough, you give them a short leash. If my common thing that I, when somebody tells me they're hiring a new salesperson, I said, great, I'll call you in 30 days. I'm going to ask you one question. Are they going to make it? And if there is any doubt, there is no doubt. And I don't care if they sold anything in 30 days. That's not the point. In 30 days, you have seen them act. And are they following and executing the actions that lead to success? It doesn't take a genius to see it. And, you know, and here's the thing. The longer that you keep an ineffective salesperson in a position, it's double the cost, because I'm paying a person who's not producing, and I've let a month go by that I didn't get production that I'll never get back in my life. So it's a double hit.
And they burn opportunities too. Oh, I mean, you're giving them leads, or you're giving them customers, or, you know, they can be the anti-sales. I mean, there's there's people that we've seen in our industry that are trying to use people in the Philippines because they're cheap labor to do outbound phone calls. And it's a disaster. I mean, because these people are making the phone calls and people are getting annoyed. Like, you're actually doing the opposite of what you should be doing. You're pushing people away, going, what kind of knucklehead company is this that puts this person on the phone to call me? No training, no management, nothing. I mean, that's why I tell them with SDRs, which are the appointment setters, the entry level people, I'm always like, hire two, because inevitably one, you're going to have to, it will either quit or get, you know, fired or something, you know. So always hire two, because 50% just never work out. Do you want me, can I comment on some of this?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. This is my last slide. So you're, it's all yours.
Okay. So one of the things I think I want to, I want to address is obviously looking at customers necessary versus discretionary. And I do agree that you don't, if you go into an industry, so like if you're sitting on top of an industry that is one of the discretionaries, you've got to really think about that. But I will say that there are the MSPs that we see that specialize in a particular niche tend to do much, much better. Like, I had a guy I just interviewed the other day. There are 20 million plus MSP in, like, and they got to 20 million fast. I mean, it was like, I mean, some acquisitions, but organic, and they just work with dentists. Well, dentists aren't going to go away anytime soon, right? So, they're solid. They're a necessity. So I think, you know, you've got to think about that. Now, if you're focused on, I don't know, hotels, like during the COVID,
So here's a good point to the dentist. And so this is where you got to think, you know, we're playing chess, not checkers. So I got to think two steps ahead. Why is it that dentists are more stable than some other sectors of the medical industry? Well, it's because 90%+ of dentists do not take assignment of insurance. So they've not sold their soul as an industry to the insurance devil, that they'll take whatever it'll pay, but you got to pay the difference. Mm-hmm. And so they have a much stronger economic model. Now, so let's take another group that's a split. Take physical therapy. So there's two types of physical therapy practices: those that take insurance assigned or predominant insurance, and those that take private pay only. And what you want to do is go to the private, you want to search out the private pay PTs, because they're going to be more consistently profitable and probably actually have better IT needs. The ones that take insurance assignment, they can't raise their prices. And so their labor keeps going up, but we're seeing massive compression in our medical clients that take insurance, to where the insurance companies are going to wait until there's denial of service and people going out of business before they get forced into raising a reimbursement rate. And it'll be too late.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think you just have to think about that from the standpoint of being, again, strategic about who you're getting mm-hmm. as a customer. Because let's face it, guys, the MSP industry isn't the only one, but a business rises and falls on the quality of customer, period. Especially when you're in a service business, because if you've got clients that won't take your advice and they fight you over everything you recommend to them, as an IT provider, their environments get noisier. They're harder to service, which means they're less profitable, because you're propping up old antiquated tech because they won't upgrade. So it's like mm-hmm. this spiral down effect that you guys have. So you have to really think about it's industry, but it's also in every industry, you're going to get the 80-20 rule, right? Just like you were just saying about physical therapy, probably 80% have sold their soul to the insurance. 20% are bold enough, smart enough, strategic enough, good at marketing, and they're profitable. So if you are going to go into a niche, you also have to think about, there's always going to be that 80-20, and you want to target the high value customer. I would also say a high value customer is a more discerning buyer, because like if I'm willing to spend on IT because I'm a growing profitable company and I'm running a good business, I know I got a lot of people who would love to have my business, but I'm going to be more discerning on who I pick to be, you know, who I pick for my IT. So to your point, mm-hmm. the service has to be there, which means you have to hire good people, which means you're going to have to charge higher fees. So it's either you're spiraling up or you're spiraling down, right? And, you know, the profitability with the current level of work you have, again, I think a lot of people think, well, you know what? If I just got all new customers around here, all my problems would be fixed. Or if I just got more customers, all my problems would be fixed. And that is rarely, rarely the case. What we typically find when we teach our members to go in and actually assess profitability by client, they mm-hmm. often find some of their highest revenue clients are the lowest margin, lowest profitability, and it's sucking everything Absolutely. Else down. So they've got to get profitable with them and their model before they start adding more. They're going to implode.
Now, one sector that people may not think about to keep an eye on is manufacturing. I mean, we're seeing the greatest reindustrialization of the U.S., and most manufacturing now is much more tech-driven, you know, than it was in the past. So I would keep an eye on building permits for new manufacturing facilities and those types of things. Is one area. Retail is kind of one of the discretionaries that we're worried about. So I would say retail and restaurants are my two most concerned, you know, groups, that if you're just in common goods, selling stuff that's can generally be available, it's just difficult to have a physical location anymore and be survivable. I mean, and everybody, when I say this, everybody has a mental picture of it. If you walk into a Walgreens drugstore, you got a 30,000 square foot building with two people in it at best. It might just be one. How do you run that facility with that? And it's like we've all come to accept stepping over boxes that still need to be stocked. You know, they're sitting in the aisles waiting until there's not a customer in the store, you know, for the front front clerk person to go do.
Right.
That shows you the cracks in the system.
Yeah, I mean, sorry, I like just swallowed a gnat or something. I don't know what's going on. I'm getting so choked up about these numbers that get so excited. Yeah, and then as far as to the sales team, you know, here's the thing that I see with smaller MSPs, they basically just, they do what I call vulture marketing. And vulture marketing is you just wait for something to die in front of you and you go jump on the carcass and fight over it with the other vultures, which is like referrals or whatever kind of floats your way. And I think in order for you to go out to go to market, you really need to have a sales playbook. It can't just like hire somebody and put that body in there and say, okay, go sell our stuff. Cause we're seeing MSPs that hire salespeople and salespeople don't even know what an MSP does. And they don't even train them. They just say, all right, go out, make some phone calls and, you know, go to some networking events and send some emails, you know, connect with some people on LinkedIn. And so I know what you're saying, like you don't need that super intelligent person, but yeah.
You know, you saying that made me stop and think for a moment. Now, I don't get to hire an MSP firm anymore because I'm part of a national firm and we have our own in-house people and I miss my previous provider.
Yeah.
But of the five previous providers that I had in the history of my firm before we merged, none of them ever contacted me prior to us selecting them. We found all of them. None of them ever found us.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And that just screams. And I honestly think that's still the general state of the market. That, you know,
yeah.
And so this is where I just drive this home to everybody. We say in simple numbers world, it takes three things to be successful. Number one, figure out what the market needs. Don't sell them what you do, figure out what they need. And I think that is the greatest. And I guarantee you, 90% of the people buying MSP services are not getting what they need. I mean, I don't think I'm being hyperbole, you know, by saying that. Mm-hmm. Second thing, can I be profitable with filling that need? Absolutely. In MSP world, you guys probably have my favorite economic model of how you make money, how you get paid, and the lowest amount of capitalization needed of any business model we work with, you know, in that, and you got the highest return on invested capital, and you're still one of the few remaining businesses that can sell for a premium if you ever did want to sell. I'm telling you, you guys are crushing it from that sense of it. But the final thing of figure out what the market needs, find a way to do it profitably is, then I tell everybody about it. And I really think the last 20 years of internet, social media, SEO has made us over-reliant on passive marketing rather than active marketing.
Yeah.
Or active marketing slash and really active selling.
Active prospecting. That's the key.
Yes.
You know, like, because what we're seeing right now, I mean, obviously election year ad rates have gone up, but all the ad spend for digital marketing, I mean, you look at it, email, there used to be a time when you could get 100% delivery rate on email and like 80, 90% response rates. That's insane. You're lucky if you get 1% at this point.
Right.
Search, organic search is still, you know, 3 to 1 times better lead will come in through our organic search than paid ads. But getting the top of organic search is more difficult than ever. You've got Google who is pushing down all the organic results for all the paid ads at the top. So if you really want to be at the top, you got to pay to get there. You can't just, you know, you know, unless you got some obscure thing that you're selling and nobody's searching on, and nobody cares about. You go, if you look at the social media sites, LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, the organic reach of a post is less than 1%. So if you want to be seen, you got to pay for it. So all the digital marketing right now is becoming more difficult to get through because it's not just other MSPs you're competing with. You're competing against every other spammer, every other advertiser, everything, right? So you know, that spend is getting more difficult. And, you know, in this election year, I mean, one of the things that we are recommending as this change of strategy right now is, of course, focus on your existing customers, get profitable with them, do proper account management, which it's still shocking to me. I mean, I just did a case study. One of our clients, Brandis Kelly, in just a year's time of just focusing purely on account management, which is good onboarding, quarterly meetings with the clients, putting together a budget for the client, putting together a roadmap, just doing that normal process, has added over $1 million in net profit. Yeah. And this is not a big company. It's not a $20 million MSP. I mean, I think they're somewhere, you know, I think they're somewhere around five million or so in revenue, 5 or 6 million. So that's a big difference. And now they're poised to go to market to go, you know, for prospecting. So right now, I think what's super important is as you go to market and spend dollars, you got to really make sure you're targeting the people you want. You got to fish in the pools. You got to change your strategy. I mean, so just to do a quick commercial right now, that's what we are going to be covering at this year's roadshow event. So I'll just share real quick. The URL is mspmarketingroadshow.com. So if you guys are interested in going there, we're only charging $100. If Karen maybe's in the background, I'll post this up here to everybody, but we're only charging $100. We do that because the sponsors basically pay for the bulk of the cost, right? And in this event, it's a 2-day event, and day one is going to be all about getting, developing, retaining high value customers right now so that you can increase your profitability and really set yourself up for success in the future. Because let's look at it this way. Let's say Greg and I are wrong. Inflation's going to go down. The labor market's going to open up. Cats are going to lie down with dogs. Everybody, money is going to be flowing. It's like the land of milk and honey. Even what I'm teaching you then, it's still going to, it's going to improve your business, right? So that is what we're going to be focusing on day one. And how do you know where the high value customers are? How do you define them? And then there are very specific marketing approaches you want to use to get them. Because Greg, I sell digital advertising. So this goes against me, but digital ads is not the best way or the first way I would go after high value customers. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, I sell it. So I'm kind of my digital team.
Yeah, it's a core piece, but it's not going to be your lead strategy. Absolutely.
It's not the lead. There's other things you could be doing right now to get in the doors of higher value customers, have that sales playbook. But then once you get them, you got to be able to close them. You got to be able to develop them. You got to be able to retain them. So that is going to be all of day one. Day two, we're going to be getting into how to use AI in your marketing. Because one of the things that is very helpful, you know, Greg, is a funny story. So my marketing team I've got a team of marketing, my sales and marketing team's like 37, 38 people now, right? So they're having this meeting and I have two people on my team that are AI experts in marketing and they're showing the team, we're teaching our team, here's how you do use it and how, you know, so forth. And there was one graphic designer that said, she raised her hand. She says, I think you guys are putting me out of a job right now. Right. You know what I mean? She's like, and yeah. So there are a lot of things that you can use AI for, content writing, graphic design, social media, data analysis. There's a lot of things you can do right now with AI that you used to have to hire a big army of people to do that can be done lightning fast, or at least like 80, 90% of the work can be done to get you started. And then you clean up the other 20% and you're saving a lot of money and time. So
it's that thing that sparks the potential customer's idea. That's interesting. That is, you know, something useful for them to know.
Yeah.
You know, so we work with a lot of marketing companies, and the one group that has had the greatest impact of negative economic outcome are freelancers in marketing, mostly freelance graphic designers that probably had their revenues cut in half this past year because of AI.
Yeah. Well, where else you're seeing it is on the low level writers, people who are just do content brochure kind of writing. That's all going to be going away. You know, and even we're testing right now, and I'll share at Roadshow what we find out, but even using AI to make phone calls, using AI to handle inbound leads, you know, just analyzing data. There's so many uses. And the thing is, you don't just go to ChatGPT. There are different AI engines with and different approaches that you want to use for different tasks. So I don't want to get into the big details of that because we're going to cover that at Roadshow. But I would urge all of you, you know, we're in this weird election year. We are seeing things slow down. And if you want to continue to grow, I'm not saying don't do marketing. That's not what I'm saying. I don't, and that's not what Greg's saying either. It's just there's an
if anything, you're doubling down. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I look at it. I'm a golfer. I look at it as this is you got to go back to the golf coach because we got to get ready for a new season of selling, and you got to get back to the fundamentals. You got to get recommitted to those things. But there's some new techniques and some new tech that you can add to that to, you know, increase your driver distance and increase, you know, the dispersion, you know, quotient. And so, I mean, it's the same thing, but I'm telling you the people, the thing that excites me that doesn't, the growth people of the marketplace, they're all concerned. Mm-hmm. I look at it as this is the business marketplace I love because guess what? I just need to outcompete the other guy. And I'll take that any day over the everybody wins scenario. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, the bar to competition is so stinking low. It just takes if they just execute on what you're saying, I mean, I'm telling you, success is, it's right in front of them.
Yeah. I mean, it's $100. You got to go to the event. Yeah. I know the travel and flight and yeah. I got all that. But again, I think there is a reset that's happening. We're seeing growth slow down and, you know, now's the time to get profitable. I really think that's more like, to me, even in my business, our focus for the remainder of this year, our theme, if you will, is get profitable, not moderate growth, but more profitability. That's really what we're focusing on right now. Getting those high value customers, serving them, keeping them, developing them. Super, super important. And most people don't think about this. It's crazy. They just wake up and they just go to work and, you know, hope that there's some money left over at the end of the day, you know, after they get done working their butt off. But
hope is not a strategy.
No. Well, not, you know, look, I mean, if you don't mind being poor, I guess that's fine. You can be broke. I just don't, right. I never could understand that. Like when you own a business, the amount of work, risk, anxiety, trouble you're going to go through is like immense. Why would you not want to make money at it if you're going to do it? And the thing is, it's not like massive change. It's like just a little different approach. Mostly what I'm doing is stiffening their spine, you know, like saying, okay, mm-hmm. you got to raise your prices. Don't tolerate this. And but then giving them the model, obviously, to do that. I mean, you just don't want to go back and just raise prices across the board. I mean, there's a strategy right. to it and an approach to it, but giving them that pathway, I just don't understand why somebody would do that. And, you know, Greg, I'll tell you another thing. There's a ton of MSPs out there because I get an email, social media outreach, something, you know, roughly every other week, I'd say is about the rate of it. And it's usually a guy. It's all guys. I can't think of one that has been a woman, but it's an older guy who's, you know, maybe 60, north of 60, been running a business for 30 years, you know, whatever. And he's tired. He's done. He's like, I want to sell. I want to get out of this thing, but nobody seems to want to, you know, pay me any kind of money. And they're kind of coming to me going, do you know of anybody who might be looking to buy? And they're kind of frustrated. And it's like, look, you know, it's one thing I can't, like, here's your options. You're either going to have to sell for whatever you're going to get and live off whatever the best you can, be a Walmart greeter or something. Mm-hmm. Because the other option is you're going to have to get in a time capsule and go back 10 years and fix your business, right? But that's not an option. Or you're just going to have to, you know, work your ass off for another 3 to 5 years to correct everything that you've done wrong to get your business to a point that is sellable. That's a viable business because even the M&A market's a little off right now in MSPs.
Oh, they have become very picky.
And, they have,
And so, but it's still there for the excellent performers, right. But you're right. You know, and the thing was, you know, 10 years ago, you could be that 65-year-old MSP owner, commit to doing the things you're talking about, And in 3 years, you could go from a $3 million business that's break even to a $5 million business that's making $1 million bottom line profit because the market was expanding. That's not available. I mean, you would really have to just be so, you'd have to find a crack in your market sector where you're aiming at. It's not saying you can't pull it off, but it's just a totally different dynamic because you've got to go steal $2 million worth of business from other MSPs.
Yeah.
And so what is your recipe that you think is so much better than what those other guys? And there are some better recipes, there's no doubt. But I'm telling you, I talk to enough, we talk to businesses every day, clients we talk to. None of them are telling me that they've heard from an MSP wanting to offer them better. Clients always talk to us about major vendor decisions. I can't think of a single client who's asked me about changing their MSP vendor, which is telling me you guys may be thinking you're knocking on enough doors. I'm telling you, there's 99% of the doors that ain't been knocked on.
Yeah. Right. But you don't want to be just out there knocking on all
No,
doors.
true.
You got to be very, very discerning. Well, I mean, even myself, like this year we'll do about 43, 44 million this year. We're not a small business. And yeah, I know people know, I can't think of a single MSP that has prospected me and trying to got my business. You would think, now I'm not inviting it because we got like what, a couple hundred people. We'll see this webinar. Now I'm going to get a whole bunch of people knocking on
But the
my
fact that
door.
nobody's asked is stunning, though.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's like you're not even trying, guys. Like, there's
Now,
no one.
I will tell you, for every non-ask for an MSP provider, I've gotten like 100 investment advisors trying to say, "Hey, can I take you to lunch? Can I talk to you about your investing strategy?" I mean, you talk about people who are in they're worse than insurance. They're more incessant now than insurance agents used to be. They just take no as a precursor to yes.
Yeah. Well, I think the business is out there. It's definitely to be had. You want to be very, I think, discretionary about where you're targeting and how you're talking to people. We're going to be going over a critical fundamental I teach is trust-based marketing, because to get those high-value clients to get in there and knock out the incumbent, switching MSPs, we hear it all the time from MSPs. They're saying that's one of the reasons people don't buy from them. They get right to the point of switching and then they pull back because they're afraid of the turbulence and the problems and everything that comes with switching an MSP. And the new guy comes in and wants to sell them a bunch of hardware, software changes, modify everything. It's disruptive, and then you could go through all that, and the doofus you hire to replace the old doofus is worse than, and so it's very, very painful. And so you have there has to be it is a trust sale, 100%. Just like your financial advisor, it's a trust sale. So knocking on doors is good, but you got to knock on doors with the in the right doors with the right message and the right positioning, because again, it's not just going to fall in your lap.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Now we got to. Can do you have a minute for a call? I just realized
Yep,
we had a couple
I'm good.
questions. Okay. So someone, it's an anonymous person saying, is it time to leave the MSP business and find a different IT related business like app developer, website
Oh,
development?
absolutely not. I mean, it's still top of the list in terms of one of my favorite business models.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm telling you, this is no fluff. I refer to this industry as the best business model of any in the industry, any other industry out there. So just be the best at it.
Yeah.
You're fine.
Yeah. You got to run a good business no matter where you go. Because if you go to app dev, guess what? Competition is fierce over there. Website development. Yeah. I mean, again, you're just, you, I, no, I would not advise that. All right. Raj says, can you comment that wages always follows inflation on GDP? So we're behind the curve of raising wages after inflation numbers are published. This delay makes it hard to raise prices in advance the inflation numbers, in advance of the inflation numbers. Clients will get the same numbers for inflation. Inflation is difficult to quantify if large companies collude, I think he means, to raise prices without costs going up. I'm not sure that that's a question, Raj.
So,
I don't. Yeah.
Well, I think I know where Roger's coming from. And so
Okay.
here's the thing. So most everybody in this industry, we have this discussion when we talk to the BFC club, and people brought up when we were talking about contract structures, you know, with your agreements. Do not put CPI in your contracts. It is such a stupid number that's not even close to reality, and you can't even play off of it to even get to the right number. So just stay away from that.
Okay.
I'm more of a, listen, defend your market. And so it's one of those things that the more that you study business, listen to things like this, you can get data points from the things we talk about and say, listen, my costs are going up and I have to run a stable business. I'm not trying to be egregiously profitable. I'm just trying to stay stable within good financial metrics. And ours for MSPs is I need $2 of gross margin for every dollar of labor. And that's going to get you a minimum of 15% profit to gross margin to 20% profit to gross margin. We think that's the appropriate number for a good long-term stable business. And they don't want you, they do not want their MSP to be financially strained. Trust me, they want you to stay in business. The good ones do. If somebody's looking for cheap, hey, they're not your customer.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the thing. You present price relative to market. What is the market value? What are the value features and benefits? And everything in the market. So you have Walmart, who has the highest amount of customers and the lowest price. You have Nordstrom, which is the highest price and the least amount of customers. I probably don't want to be either one. I want to be somewhere in the elbow of that price elasticity curve that's high enough on value. High enough on number of customers, but high enough on the price that's there, that it meets a good fit. And that's where Robin was talking about earlier of choosing what is that customer profile range that I want to live in. But at the end of the day, the only example I'm going to say is, listen, you know, my labor costs keep going up because I live in a very short skill set availability of labor model. And you know, I am just pacing with what my inflation. Never defend your inflation relative to the market. It's irrelevant because those numbers are flawed anyway. And so you know what your numbers are. And I guarantee you, you've got to adjust your price relative to that. And if you lose a customer that, you know, it's big of me to say, you know, I'm spending your money. But I'm telling you, we have just not had clients lose any good customers because of raising prices that are I'm talking about reasonable raising of prices.
Right.
And here's the thing. I'm more in favor of a contract structure where you can raise prices anytime and the customer has 60 to 90 days to opt out of the contract. And the worst thing you can do is get locked into multi-year agreements because I'm telling you, inflation isn't going away.
So a question that came up was, what is CPI? It's Consumer Price Index. So you would not agree with saying, hey, we have the right to raise rates no more than 5% over inflation or CPI every year on the anniversary of this contract. You're saying that's, you would not advise it.
I would not advise people. I would say, you know, we'll present you, we'll give you 60 days. If we raise prices, we'll give you 60 days to review. The most I'll commit is 12 months to the price. Mm-hmm. But after that, I'm going to present a price and you gotta, you know, you can shop it, you can do whatever, but I'm going to raise prices relative to a very dynamic marketplace. And I got to be conscious that if I push it too far, you're going to leave me. And if I don't push it far enough, I'm going to go out of business. As simple as that.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Let me see. Was there anything? I don't see any other questions. There was a question that came in the chat. They were asking about the $20 million MSP that was focused on dental. That is Sunset Technologies. And I just did an interview with them and I'll be posting that on MSP Success Magazine. But, you know, it was kind of interesting for them because they are, the guy even said, he said, maybe you can help me with marketing because, you know, here's what we're doing. I was like, hey, that's exactly what I would recommend that you do. You know, he's doing trust-based marketing. So, all right, Greg, well, this has been great.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. Always.
Yeah. And so guys, again, make sure you get registered for Roadshow, MSPMarketingRoadshow.com. We have got three locations. It will be the same event, same content at all the locations. We're not doing a virtual event. Dallas, Newark, and Las Vegas. Las Vegas is almost sold out as we, you know, because every year it always does,
Newark's,
you know.
Newark's not sold out.
Yeah, I know. Can you imagine? I mean, but Newark, here's the thing. It's funny. Newark is always such a great show for us. The people that show up, we get a good turnout rate. The people there are really good. And then Dallas and Chicago, we always kind of pick somewhere in the middle of the country to kind of, you know, hit that market. But Newark is, the people there are great. And they come from New York and Philadelphia and Boston and all that East Coast.
We got quite a few clients in that area. So I love to pick on them.
Yeah. No, it's not a very sexy area. That you're right. Although I did find a really good French restaurant last time we went there. I can't remember. I'll have to go back and look it up.
They do know food up in that area. There's no doubt.
So great. Well, thank you so much. Guys, get registered for Roadshow before we sell out and all the tickets, that is. And let's get after it. So Greg, thank you so much.
Thanks. All right, see you, buddy.
Bye now.